Welcome, everyone. And I'm Jon Foster-Pedley. I'm Dean of Henley Africa. This is an opportunity, as Memo has said, and thanks for setting up, Memo, to talk to people who really have a point of view, a voice, and a passion for things that really matter in our lives going forward. I'm going to start. What the format will be, we'll introduce everybody. We'll talk a little bit about, Henk, maybe you'll say a few words about your sort of position on all this, and then we'll open up by asking specific questions of you. However, it's really important that everyone who's listening and here, and I'm so pleased you came, uses the chat and the Q&A function to ask us questions, because we will respond to them in case, unless I miss them. Or if I miss them, just go straight to Mamo and ask her a question. And we'd love to get your questions and challenges and pushback on everything, because this is such an important area. I'm passionate about it, obviously. So, but anyway, let's go to the people who really know something. Henk Sa.
Yes. thank you, Jon. Okay, let's start with introductions. My name is Henk Sa. I'm one of the partners at EcoMetrix. I am originally from the Netherlands. Many years ago, I worked for a company called EcoSecurities. This was when, I guess this was the first hype of climate change and climate change mitigation. We listed a company on the London Stock Exchange, and from the money we set up offices around the world, mainly in the developing world, and that's what brought me here. When in 2007, JP Morgan bought a company and delisted it, the question was if I wanted to move back to Europe or stay here. And I decided to stay here, and me and the rest of the team did a management buyout, and we carried on under the name EcoMetrix. Our primary focus is what we sort of inherited from our days at EcoSecurities, was the development of climate change mitigation projects, mainly in the energy sector, but also beyond that in the waste and afolu sector. We do, in addition to project development, we do sort of policy consulting, and we have an IT platform that does climate change monitoring and reporting.
Well, thank you very much. And, you know, I'm Jon Foster-Pedley. I'm the Dean of Henley Africa. We're an international business school. I'm not going to rave on about that. But we have movements. One of the things that drives me is that I'm a late dad to a 15-year-old and a 16-year-old entering this world. And I'm more and more concerned about the world that I've left them. We've left them if we don't watch out. And it's becoming clearer and clearer that there's an obligation here to do something about it. And this really matters to me. We've launched something called Henley Earth, which is environmental activism through research and training at Henley. Yeah, we like our acronyms. And we've also recently just tied up with TED Countdown to reduce emissions by 50% to 2030. And we're going to be doing a TED Countdown TEDx later on this topic in early December, which I'll be looking for people to help with. And that's us. So the purpose of this is really to provoke. And Charles, thank you very much. Charles, I know your organization. Charles Appleby, please read that. Planting trees. That'd be great to hear a bit more about that as well. But we can do that. But Henk, what's your motivation for all this? Why are you passionate about it? It's not just cerebral, is it?
No. It's I think a bit more fundamental, partially also being a father and thinking about future generations. But I think more on a, in addition to that, I enjoy the puzzle. It's a complex, multidisciplinary, multi-sectoral, global problem, which I find something very appealing to get involved in and try and, you know, participate in solving it, which I think is definitely a possibility, right? This is not a unsolvable problem. People often go from being interested in the topic to being convinced that it's not solvable and we should just ignore it. I'm not one of those people. I think it is something that can be solved, and the puzzle in how we can solve this as a global community is what fascinates and drives me.
Well, a lot of people would disagree with you on that, wouldn't they? And a lot of people wouldn't even believe there's a problem. How do you feel when you get somebody who comes up to you and say, this is all fake news, fake science? I mean, your blood must boil somehow. How do you handle that? And how do you respond?
I think it's vested interest, right? It's the same movement that back in the 70s had doctors go on TV saying that smoking was a good thing. I'm sure that the movement is still in the right direction, although there are still quite a few climate change denialists and quite heavy lobbying and undermining the science, so to say. But I think all in all, over the last years, by calling out these people and calling out where they come from, I think it's sort of slowly moving in the direction that everybody is aware of the actual problem and understands the actual magnitude of it, instead of, you know, constantly debating, is it real and should we do something about it?
And you've just said that you reckon we can do something about it.
Okay, absolutely, yeah.
That's like a big problem, a big challenge. So let's have your template, your roadmap, your framework in thinking. What, how can we think about this to come to the same conclusion as you, Henk?
Well, first, I think a good starting point is to recognize that we've successfully done these kind of things before, right? When I was a teenager, there was this big thing called acid rain, and it was because of NOx and SOx emissions, and it resulted to trees dying and stuff like that, with, you know, sort of clear policy interventions driving different investment decisions on the private sector side. That problem has pretty much gone away in a decade and a half. Fair enough, this is local air pollution related, so it's not as global a problem as you would have with climate change. But when you look at it more from a global context, we used to have a hole in the ozone layer. That's no longer there. It took one protocol, the Montreal Protocol, that, again, put policies in place globally, a global framework in place that then resulted to local policies. And that problem resolved itself in a matter of 20 years. Now, I'm sure this is a larger problem, and it's more profound and it's more fundamental. But I don't see any reason why we cannot have the same level of success as we had in the past with these kind of environmental problems. It all starts with recognizing there is a problem and understanding what it is.
What was the turning point for you that you really recognized this was a problem, Hank? Was it the science of it, or was it just kind of a massive understanding slowly coming to you, or was it an epiphany moment when you're walking along the cliffs or having a shower?
No, it's... Well, in my specific case, it was, as I mentioned, right? I come from the Netherlands, which is a country that lies below the sea level. And for me, the realization on the practical impact was when I saw these pictures from space about the ever-shrinking polar ice cap, the North Pole. Now, interestingly enough, the North Pole doesn't, melting of the North Pole is obviously a sign of climate change. It does not lead to rising sea levels, and therefore it doesn't actually put my native country in more risk of going under. Although at that stage, I hadn't developed my understanding of it that far. So that was the reason, that's when it first clicked for me how the practical implications of climate change could look like.
So I've been listening to Roger Hallam from Extinction Rebellion, you know, who's a very outspoken, you know, Cassandra doomsayer, really. I don't know if he's a doomsayer or right, where he's talking about the potential of climate science, climate change, killing billions of people. How do you respond to that? Is it, you know, I'm not saying whether he's right or wrong. Do you think that's an exaggerated response? Or do you think that this could go that way?
No, I don't. Well, I mean, it could, in the long term, results contribute to the extinction of mankind, right? Then again, if you look back over the millions of years in Earth's history, species have never been around forever, right? Some, you know, persist a couple of hundred million years longer than others, but eventually they all demise. So I'm not convinced that we will be here forever. We will definitely be here for the next couple of thousand years, assuming there's no, you know, planet-killing event. I don't think climate change is so much a extinction kind of threat. I think it's more of a poor housekeeping thing, whereby at some point we will have to explain to our grandchildren, how do we make such a mess of this? And we knew about it and we didn't do anything about it. I think that's more of a sort of the you know, conscious kind of thing, which I find more of a problem. then this notion of it will kill all human life or even all life on Earth, which it won't.
Let's challenge that. Okay.
Sure.
So we've got COP coming up shortly. We've got a massive drive to reduce emissions. We've got China producing the most, sort of carbon emissions in the world, expanding, still an expanding economy. Other people following that. And what's to stop and the developing countries saying, why should we take all the burden of cutting down on emissions when you're the guys who created this? What's to stop that dynamic happening, Henk? Where everyone, it's a tragedy of the commons. What's to make us all collaborate here?
Well, for one, because I think we can. I think we all are, as humans, quite comfortable in working together instead of working apart. And I think it's also, it's a shared interest, right? It's not that there will be winners from climate change and losers from climate change. It is exactly what it says on the tin. The climate will change. Partially for worse, partially for better, but generically speaking, it will change. So the infrastructure you've built, doesn't matter which country, in the past will no longer be suitable in the future from purely climate change-related impacts. When it comes to the difference between industrialized and developing countries, and yes, it's a correct argument to make that industrialized countries benefited from the industrial revolution and therefore contributed disproportionately to climate change we're seeing now, and we will see into the future compared to developing countries. But I think actually part of these COP negotiations have always been on that premise that, you know, everybody should contribute, but on a diversified and appropriate level, whereby you take into account how much they've contributed to it, and also how much they've benefited from, well, mainly economically benefited from their historic emissions.
So your organization is EcoMetrix Africa. Mm-hmm. And you're providing policy advice, but at the same time as policy advice, so let's talk about policy advice you're offering in a moment. So, you know, what are the, if you look at South Africa as a country, what's our situation with emissions and with global warming? And what are you advising people to do that is rationally doable?
So we're actually quite, somewhere between famous and infamous, I guess, climate change, from a climate change point of view. We have, for one, we have the largest greenhouse gas emitter in the world under one brand name in the form of Eskom. And we have the largest single point source emissions in the world. And that's the Secunda facility from Sasol. So in that sense, when it comes to emissions, we definitely stand our ground globally. When it comes to doing something about it, in all fairness, I think we're doing reasonably okay. We've introduced a carbon tax. We've been quite effective in executing that so far. We see a carbon market evolving around that. There's new policy in the making when it comes to a actual climate change bill and a sort of carbon budgeting system. We've participated very actively in the global negotiations when it comes to the development of what they call an NDC, a National Determined Contribution, which is sort of a country's roadmap to reducing its emissions, which then filters into a global roadmap of reducing your emissions. So I would say all in all, we've done, in addition to the fact that from our history, we have a very carbon intensive infrastructure, we've been quite active when it comes to working together with other countries to doing something about it. Not saying we're there yet, but we're definitely on the way.
Well, that is optimistic, especially with the imminent apparent collapse of Eskom, which seems to be on our, I'm not saying it is collapsing, but with the challenges that Eskom's going through. We've seen a change in the presidential advisory around sort of creation of and distribution of alternative energy. How do you think that's going to work out for South Africa?
I think that's going to work out well. I think actually that's one of our, you know, when we talk about things like the pandemic and climate change, people phrase it in terms of building back better. I think renewable energy and distributed renewable energy is should be one of the, if not the primary pillar when it comes to doing that. This notion that we can carry on like we have for the last 50 years by building very large fossil fuel-based power plants to provide electricity to the entire country, I think that's outdated, not only from a how you build an energy infrastructure, but also from a climate change point of view. I think we will drive job creation and other things that are very important to a country like South Africa by moving towards distributed renewable energy generation. Imagine that we move from mining, often in very poor conditions, to installing and maintaining solar panels on households. I think that's a positive outlook and a decent, you know, building back better a narrative. So I think that's I think that's one of the main drivers: renewable, distributed renewable energy.
So thanks. Here's one that'll be right up your street. It's from Stephen Lim in the Q&As, and he says, "As we know, developing countries are lower global carbon emitters globally. Okay. How can we price our carbon credit to the rest of the world? This should allow for faster technology / solution transfer to developing countries and foreign direct investment." Okay, that's an interesting question. Now, I'm sure this is really in your line because you are running a consultancy on carbon credit commercialization. So I'll leave it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. So a carbon credit, I think there's two fundamentals to it, right? It reduces emissions below what the emissions would have been in the absence of a mitigation project, right? So a practical example, instead of making electricity with a coal-fired power station, you switch off the coal-fired power station and you plant a bunch of wind farms or solar power plants, and you generate the same electricity but with zero emissions. The difference between the emissions per unit of electricity you would have had from the coal-fired station and that of the wind farm is what you can claim as a carbon credit. So that's aspect number one, which basically from a South African point of view or from a developing country point of view means that the more emissions you have, the more emissions you can reduce, and therefore the more emission reductions you and more carbon credits you can generate, right? So that's concept number one. Concept number two, when it comes to price, it's because there is no link between where the greenhouse gas emissions happen and where the climate change impact occurs. From where I sit, a carbon credit should be worth the same thing anywhere in the world, because they represent the mitigation of global climate change, not more or less rainfall in a specific area or sea level rises in another specific area. It is a global carbon credit, and from what I demise, that should also result in a global carbon price. That is not the case at the moment. There is a fragmented carbon market which has endless deviations in rules across the world, and that leads to different markets and therefore widely ranging prices for these carbon credits.
So when you and your consultancy are advising companies how to mitigate their carbon use, I mean, what are the key elements of advice you're giving? I'm sure there's plenty of people here listening who are running organizations within them, waiting for the flights to start, but guilty about them. How can you advise us, any of these companies, to mitigate their carbon use?
Okay, so there's, I would say there's two aspects to it, right? One, you need to look at your own operations and look at how you can. Nobody wants stranded assets. So nobody's saying, well, you should switch off your factory because it creates greenhouse gas emissions. So you look at this from a medium to long-term perspective, and you build into your investment decision process the cost of climate change, either via having to buy offsets for the emissions you have or stuff like that. You create what is often referred to as a shadow price internally. This gets filtered into your investment decision, and that is how you, over the medium to long term, move away from your carbon intensive assets to more carbon neutral investment assets as a company. That is obviously a medium to long term trajectory. So in the meantime, you would need to either do some quick fixes, right? Energy efficiency kind of interventions and stuff like that. Or you offset by the acquisition of emission reductions. And there you meet another aspect. Most of people in business would say, yeah, I can reduce some of my emissions and I can offset some of it, but some of my emissions are just inherent in what I do, right? As a result of my production process, there will always be some greenhouse gas emissions. You would be able to offset those. So that would mean you can either buy those offsets, or if you go a little bit more upstream from that, you can actually develop projects which are outside of your normal business operations that only have one purpose, and that is to reduce emissions and have those emissions recognized as carbon credits, and therefore be able to offset the emissions you feel you cannot actually reduce in your own operations. That is sort of the, you know, rough outline of a emission reduction roadmap. From my the main thing we tell companies is that the notion that this might go away and this might become less is the same as back in the 90s, somebody thinking, well, you know, maybe this email thing will go away and I can just keep on writing memos and have my secretary put them in the mail. There is no future in which climate change is not a topic. And I would assume it only gets more and more and a larger part of business decision components instead of less.
I listened to a TED talk by a Norwegian environmentalist and climate scientist. Mm-hmm. He gave a very good illustration. He started off by giving the whole story about we're going to die in our millions, economies are going to crash and whatever. And I'm not saying he was wrong about that, but he made that case very strongly. And then he gave a sort of high-level case. And then he illustrated how both those forms of communication didn't achieve action. So if you want people to, if you want to create a movement now that people are really going to move on and really going to make a change, how do you think is the best way to get to them, Henk? How do we communicate?
Money, right? Hit them in the pockets. That's, I guess, the only thing that always works. I think you should start with information and education so that people understand what the impacts of their behavior and their choices are, both at a personal and at a business level. But if I in practical terms see when things start actually moving is when there is an actual carbon price, right? So for the last 15 years, I've been developing projects here in South Africa, and in the first couple of years, when there was a high global carbon price, things moved really fast and there was lots of activities. Then after the financial crisis, the carbon market collapsed and there was virtually no activity. With the introduction of the local carbon tax here, activity has spiked again. So I think there's a direct correlation between if you either reward the reduction of emissions or you penalize financially the emission of greenhouse gases, I think that's the main instrument of driving change. Leaving it to, you know, people making the moral right choice is less effective and less sharp a tool than hitting them in the pocket, I think.
Right. So you're talking about offset projects, et cetera. And Charles has asked, Charles Appleby's asked, what is the SA carbon price in US dollars? But Charles, I'm going to ask you to come on in a second, if I may, because you actually have a project, which is about planting trees. It might qualify as an offset project, wouldn't it? Is that what I mean? And I'd really like us to share and hear a little bit about that. But what is the local SA carbon price at the moment in dollars? Do you know, Henk? I'm sorry to ask. Yeah. I could Google it and find out, but you would probably know.
I do this for a living, so it's actually $7.88. That was close of business last night. But yes, depending on changing of the rand dollar exchange over the last 12 hours, that is the price of a carbon tax offset in South Africa at the moment. Yes.
Thanks, and welcome to Charles Appleby. Thank you very much for being willing to do this, Charles. I hope your mic's on off mute.
Yeah, really welcome
if you would share a bit about your thoughts on this, what are you doing, and what your project is as well.
Yeah, happy to do that.
Henk will tell you whether it's going to work.
So I missed the figure, Henk, for the carbon price in South Africa.
$7.88 or $7. What is it? 113 rands, give or take.
Okay, $7. Okay, that's interesting. Yeah, so what my project's about, it's what I'm doing is really two things. One is I wanted a way to make it easy for people to take action on global warming, and that's where the planting trees came in, because it's very, very easy to do. You can do it from a computer, you make a donation. We plant a load of trees with a through a partner, and some of those trees are going into Madagascar, Mozambique, some of the African countries. But wherever the trees are going, they're helping people, people in families and people in extreme poverty. They're helping them by providing paid work, and also they're creating new habitats, so new areas of mangroves, new areas of forests, so that basically there's places for wildlife to live. Very, very interesting discussion you've just had about the global carbon price. There's a guy here in the UK I must introduce you to, Henk, because he's doing work in the UK. But just a couple of comments on that. I think that one of the reasons for local markets and local pricing is that there's going to be a lot of regulations. Like the UK is saying, yes, you can have carbon offsets, but those offsets must be processed in the UK. So you must plant trees in the UK. And so there's a report just came out in the last 2 days where the UK OBR, so this is a very, very important organization, Office of Budgetary Responsibility. And just reading their stuff this morning, they're talking about a carbon price of £101. So that's what, $140 in 2026. So they're talking about big figures here. So I think there will be, I do think that there will be different prices in different markets. And a similarity to this, of course, is what's happened with oil. I mean, you can get oil out the ground in Saudi Arabia and Bahrain and these places incredibly cheaply. You can get oil out of the North Sea, which the UK has done, for quite a high price. And then you can pay even more money to dig it out the ground using fracking, which obviously a lot of people are not happy with anyway, but it is higher cost. And of course, if the oil price keeps below a certain level, then people will not be doing fracking because it's just not cost effective. So I think there's some very, very interesting things going on with the market there. But getting back to the trees, we've got a similar situation with the trees. I mean, I think there's a logical argument which Bill Gates picks up on in his book, which is to say that logically the price for carbon, the world price for carbon, is the price by a mechanical industrial process to remove CO2 from the air. Now, we don't really yet have a price for that because the projects that are ongoing are experimental. They're not at industrial scale. So, but I mean, roughly that price is going to be of the order of $100 a ton. Hopefully that would come down in time because, you know, a lot of people's plans depend on removing CO2 from the air and all sorts of crazy things. But with the trees, I mean, again, with the trees, it depends where you plant the trees. I mean, when I looked at our project, I thought, oh, well, we'll plant trees in Scotland. It'd be really nice because there used to be a forest in Scotland, the Caledonian Forest, before it was in the 1700s. For some reason, it was cut down by the English, of course. So, you know, it used to be a forest, really nice idea. But the prices I got for planting trees are just crazy. I mean, it costs 50, that's 50 times less to plant trees in Madagascar than it does in the UK. So it just doesn't make any sense. So in terms of what's going on with climate change, absolutely, I believe we should be planting up the tropics first, the lowest cost places, Madagascar, Mozambique, whatever, Kenya, these places, plant the lowest cost places. And then when they're full up, and by the way, that'll be a while because potentially in Madagascar, apparently there's space for getting on for 1 trillion trees in Madagascar alone, because so much has been deforested. So once those places are fully planted up, then move on to more expensive places, and then planting in Europe, North America, etc. But of course, at the moment, there is a demand for offsets in the UK and Europe, local offsets, as I've described, which would be at a much higher price than we're talking about. So, I mean, we don't put our price in terms of dollars per ton of CO2. What we do, we position it in terms of, if you're living in the UK, you're creating about 7 tons of CO2. Therefore, you should be planting 1,750 trees, one-time payment to plant those trees. And then those trees, on average, for every year they're growing, those trees will then remove all your CO2 emissions. So that's the formula we're using. But what it amounts to a price around $2 a ton. It's $2 a ton of CO2. Is what it comes down to.
So are you saying, Charles, that, and sorry, Henk, yeah, go ahead, Henk, sorry, go ahead, please.
Yeah, so there are quite lengthy discussions and angles on what the price of carbon should be and where it should come from, right? Does it come from the actual cost, or should it be the price that's, you know, the Stern report looks at it for, the price should be equal to the cost of restoring the impact in the future, right? That's how the Stern report looks at it. Other angles to look at it are, well, the price needs to be so high to change investment decisions. So it needs to be punitive up to the point that you would do it in a different way, right? You should make use of oil so expensive by taxing the carbon component that renewables become the cheaper option. That's the angle. One thing I wanted to say, I mean, I think your approach about the planting of trees and sort of offsetting your own personal emissions by a once-off of sort of donation, I think that works. I think that's a very good idea. It's the kind of initiatives that you see globally, and I think they all have a you know, specific angle to it. And I think it drives activism on that perspective, on that in this direction. What it is there is a difference between reducing greenhouse gas emissions, or in this case, capturing carbon, and generating carbon credits, right? So, and what sits in between are what they call carbon standards, like the clean development mechanism or the voluntary carbon standard and things like that. And they set a whole bunch of rules around, okay, you reduce greenhouse gas emissions, but now you need to hit these rules to actually make that into carbon credits. And the reason for that is that when something becomes a carbon credit, it goes to the other side of the fence and it is offset against a ton of CO2 emitted, or CO2 equivalent emitted, that we know for sure will happen, right? So there can be no ambiguity on the actual ton that was removed from the atmosphere forever, because the other side of the equation, that ton will be emitted, will definitely exist. So that's where, between reducing emissions and carbon credits, are these quite stringent carbon standards to address this this concern, right? Because what you would not want is a carbon credit being issued relatively easily, and then being used to offset real emissions, which are quite solid. Then the system works in reverse, right? The carbon accounting no longer adds up.
Yeah. Thank you. There's a very good question here, though. This is a good one from Celeste Tema. Charles, do you have projects in South Africa? Because if it's cheaper to plant your trees here, you can create employment by sending us some UK funds to plant up some of our wonderful areas.
We work with a tree planter partner. No, I'm sorry, they don't have a project actually in South Africa. We can talk to them to see what their plans are. I think particularly important is that they're pushing their plans into Brazil. And there's a very, very big need in Brazil, as I see it, because of the political dimension. I mean, people there, there's indigenous people who are looking after the existing forests, and those people are being killed. They're literally being murdered. They're being ambushed and being murdered by the vested interest of the loggers. I mean, there's a need everywhere in the world. So I'll see what our tree planter has to say about South Africa. But there's a big need across the whole world. But I think a very interesting question is apart from the technicalities of the carbon price and what it should be, and as Henk has said, the issue of incentives and all this sort of thing. I think the other thing is really what the sort of questions are as to what people can and should do about climate change. So by the way, I don't call it offsetting. So what we're doing is we're removing CO2, because that's what the trees actually do. The trees remove the CO2 emissions. In the offset space, as people know, there are some projects which are called avoided emissions, which are a little bit different. But I mean, in terms of what trees do, trees remove CO2 emissions, to remove CO2 from the air, and therefore the line of removing emissions, removing your carbon footprint, is what we do. But as I say, I think there's a very interesting discussion about what people can do. And so as a voluntary activity, we're all creating CO2 emissions. As say in the UK, 7 tons, in the US, 16 tons, which needs 4,000 trees to remove all that. And so I'm very interested in combining what we're doing with action by individuals to make voluntary contributions to plant trees, and those people to cut their CO2 emissions themselves by whatever means, but also the opportunity everyone has to multiply their impact. And everyone can do this just by talking to people around you. And we had a webinar the other week where someone said, well, look, what's really important is that you talk to people who actually don't agree with you. You talk to people you don't know, and so you don't know what their views are. And you talk to people who don't agree, because otherwise we're at risk of just being in this sort of echo chamber where we all agree, and there's hordes of people out there who don't agree and think we're bonkers.
Well, let's take that, if I could, for both of you. Let's get it down to a very sort of pragmatic, simple level now. Okay, and that, because we can talk about the more cerebral things, and particularly the more activist things that we must address about some of the awful things going on in the world, particularly what Bolsonaro has done or simulated in the Amazon basin. We now know it's about 1,700 tons of CO2 that I'm producing, or you're producing a year here in South Africa. I've got to get, what was it?
Seven tons per person.
Seven tons, I was about to say, that's an awful lot of cows, or the equivalent. And we've got seven tons. I've got to get rid of that. So, is it just a matter of turning off lights? And what are these sort of three or four critical things we can do, firstly, to change our behaviors? And secondly, how do we go about getting outside our echo chambers? Let's take that one after the other. Henk, what do you think we should do to make a difference in our own life?
Well, I would go, as I said in the beginning, right? South Africa, as a result of its history, has a very carbon-intensive energy infrastructure. So anything you can do to either improve the efficiency of that, efficient light bulbs and stuff like that, or you can move it to renewables, install solar panels on your house and stuff like that. So South Africa's carbon footprint, about 70% is the emissions are from the energy infrastructure, right? So from electricity generation and, in our specific case, petrol and diesel generation production. So if you address the energy side of things, that gets you the furthest to it. An electric car would be a good idea, assuming it runs on solar panels and not on fossil fuel, because otherwise it actually doesn't really help, but it actually becomes a little bit worse. But so if you think about it from an energy point of view, that's where
that in our heads. So you buy an electric car, apart from the fact you can't charge it yet, but that'll happen. You charge it with electricity that's been produced by digging coal out the ground and putting smoke in the air, right? So that's not going to help.
Yes.
We actually have to change the grid and the way we work with Eskom, right?
Yes. The climate change mitigation part is the renewable energy source. It's not so much the electric car as such, because if you charge the electric car with a fossil fuel grid, it doesn't really help. It's not completely true if you run the numbers on small distances, because our diesel and petrol in South Africa is even more carbon intensive than the ones you get from Saudi Arabia and elsewhere, because we produce it from coal mainly. for short distances, so if you're a small car in a city, you would actually, even if you charge it from a coal-based electricity grid, you would still reduce your emissions because you reduce that very carbon in. But generally speaking, it's all about where does the energy come from primarily.
So what else?
Exactly. One of the things and South Africans love their meats. I've come to recognize that as a foreigner who moved here. I would introduce one day a week where you don't eat meat. That has a massive impact on the remaining part of your carbon footprint. Becoming a vegetarian every Monday is good for the climate. That's because the meat production industry is very carbon intensive, because animals have multiple stomachs and as a result have lots of methane emissions, which is a potent greenhouse gas. So that would be one way of going. And then I would think, anything you can recycle, sort of the last part of it, the waste stream. Anything you can recycle means, well, I guess it means two things. One, we don't need to spend all the energy making new ones, which in many cases comes with fossil fuel energy consumption. So if you can recycle some of the plastics out of your waste, that would also contribute at a personal level to reducing your carbon.
Start looking to alternative energy, cars and vehicles, buy a real bike.
Even better.
Okay, thanks. Do you agree with that, Charles?
First thing to do, John, is to divide the problem into two. So first of all, you've got the things that governments need to do and the things that individuals can do. Because the government action is really, really big. I mean, we've had a great discussion about decarbonizing electricity and the current big dependence that South Africa has, for example, on coal. Now, that's something that the government needs to take a lead on. And what I think is really important is that with the right structures, what any government can do is to arrange it so that they put in a small amount of money, they use regulations to drive investment and create an opportunity. So if you create, particularly in the current market where worldwide interest rates are paying almost nothing, if you create a situation where you create a thing where a business can take a revenue stream of 6 or 7% out of building this massive infrastructure for the government, then everyone's going to be very happy, because with the right regulations, private enterprise will build this stuff for the government. So the main heading here is decarbonizing electricity. And the second one, which we've touched on also, is basically moving everything to electric. So we've talked about cars. In the early stages, of course, the electricity is not going to be decarbonized. There's not going to be enough chargers, the range of the cars, all these sort of issues. But for me, these are teething issues. There will be people who will buy electric cars early on, but then the bulk of people want a low-cost car. I mean, how many people buy a brand new car? Well, people in the UK buy brand new cars because they're financed and the incentives. But there's a lot of people who would normally buy a second-hand car. So, you know, it's going to be a while before they buy an electric car unless there's some real incentives. But the other big things that governments can do, of course, is governments can plant trees. You know, I mean, if a government offers match funding to businesses, if you've got the space, if you've got the deforested areas like your area behind you, Henk, you know, governments can plant trees. And really, really important is for a lot of the world is for government to stop deforestation. And by stopping deforestation, I don't know how much of a problem you have with this in South Africa. I mean, certainly there's an issue in the Democratic Republic of Congo, where they've got massive existing rainforests and pressure on from mining and all sorts of situations. But it's really, really important to stop deforestation. And there are causes of that which a government can deal with. A lot of them are to deal with poverty and illegality, which need to be tackled. Of course, the recycling is in most countries, like in the UK, the recycling is actually dependent on the government having recycling process plants in place. So, I mean, you know, what I need to do, I need to put the recycled stuff in the right bin, and then it goes off to the plant and will be sorted out by the government. But say you've got this whole heading of what the of what governments need to do, and then you've got a second heading of what individuals can do. And so with individuals, we've touched on it, really, really important is for everyone to think about cutting their CO2 emissions as much as they can within the context of where you're living, whether it's in South Africa or any other country in the world. Cutting your CO2 emissions, of course, this is fundamental. Then, having done that, what can you do to remove your CO2 emissions? For example, voluntarily planting trees, like we've discussed. And as I said already, really important is to talk to other people, talk to people around you, talk to people that you meet, people that you know, and obviously without irritating them, but to make the point that there is a problem, there is an issue here. You know, the world is in trouble with all of this, and what do people think about it, and what can we kind of should we be doing about it?
There's a bit of a challenge to that. I mean, how can you talk about something that might have such an existential effect on our children and generations going forward without some confrontation? And I'm not advocating doing that, but surely quiet, gentle persuasion and sort of tea room rationality and politeness is not gonna work. When you look at the difference between, you see what's happening in America between Trump supporters and you know, between Democrats, some part of the Democrat Party and some part of the Republicans. I mean, there's no reason in that. There's no politeness. How the heck do we get people to realize if this is so serious, how do we do it? And maybe, I don't know, which of both of you can answer that.
Well, I think here, John, I think actually we do have to start with politeness because, you know, when the news comes on, immediately I see what's going on in the news, what's happening. And I was speaking to a lovely lady that I know a short while ago, and she felt that by doing recycling, she was doing her bit for climate change. Now, I mean, recycling is important. It's not difficult to do in the West where we are, but the calculation I've done shows that recycling is worth about 1% of my CO2 emissions. But, you know, she's a lovely person and I know in a different context. So I thought, well, look, I'm not going to argue with you about this. But this, I think the thing is, despite all the news, you know, I mean, it's a great conversation with people to say that, you know, the heat in Northwest, the US and Canada. My wife said last night, she'd been watching the news and she said, hey, there's record temperatures in Lapland. You know, I mean, this is a conversation opener. You know, in the UK, we're having one of the worst summers we've had. You know, we're desperate for a hot, sunny day. And it's damn well hotter in Lapland than it is in here near London. I mean, it's just, you know, I mean, that's people in the UK love talking about the weather. So let's talk about the weather. You know, why is it crazily hot in Lapland when it's, you know, right, when it's like April right here in the UK?
Thanks. So I'm going to, so we're sure we're coming to the end. We only got a few more minutes and it's been a really interesting stuff. Robert, what about you, Henk? I mean, you know, forgive me, but Dutch people have a reputation for being able to be blunt if they want to be. I mean, is this an approach? I'm not stereotyping entirely. I'm just saying, you know.
The Dutch are very blunt. That is just that we don't see it like that, but I mean, you know, others definitely recognize it as such. We call it being direct. Which I think is actually, no, it aligns with Charles' point. It is, you should point it out and call it out. And I think, you know, when it comes to individuals, it should be more from an informative point of view. But when it comes to lobbying and policy groups, I think you should call it out clearly and loudly. One of the initiatives I've always been a fan of is what they call the carbon dinosaur. It's an initiative, I think it's from Greenpeace, and during every COP, it's going to be the same in Glasgow, I think, is they every day hand out an award to the country that is part of these negotiations that has been the least constructive when it comes to solving this problem. And every year at the entrance of the venue is this booth from the Carbon Dinosaur, and they get handed out this award. And I think that's right. You should point out and I don't think you should go as far as naming and shaming, but you should also not let people get away with these fake news and obstructive approaches to trying to solve this problem.
Thank you. And there's so many more comments. Lovely comment there by Dan Mayola about, you know, encourage recycling, water management. I mean, we ran out of water in Cape Town. allocated in the wrong places. You know, farmers using it, taking it out the rivers before it gets to damp, population growth, no infrastructure, changing habits. We've got a massive change ahead of us here. We have to change the way we think about these. But it's not a matter of, but it always is a motivation, because for me, when I see, I was brought up in England, Charles, you know, and I intimately know nature there. I spend a lot of time outside walking all my childhood, really, you know, doing fiction, doing the stuff that one does. And it pains me personally when I hear that nature is limited, that says, I mean, species are dying out and ecodiversity is changing and sinking. I take it personally. And I think maybe we need to take this personally in that way, not intellectually, but a personal sense that the animals and creatures around us, the world we love, the life we like and want our children to have, is evaporating unless we do something about it. So my last question is, if you had to advise, this is more of a movement than a debate, isn't it? How do you create a global movement that is not, because we've seen what happened to Extinction Rebellion, fantastic ideas, and most movements, say, implode and go through all sorts of iterations, or they become too extreme in this way or that way, but there's a learning process. How would you encourage us all to create movements in our life to push that forward? And thank you. I see the Met webinar, How to Mobilize Public Support to Stop Global Warming, Thursday. I look forward to being there, Charles. Thank you.
Please do. Okay. This is just the speakers are all young people, and that provides that provides extra energy. Yeah.
Unlike me, you two certainly are. Okay. What do you think, Henk?
What for me it is, it does have to come from policy, from governments. This is a global problem, and although we can contribute ourselves, the best thing we can do is make our vote count. And I think what is important for every government, including the South African government, is during the COP in next December, agreement needs to be reached on Article 6 of the Paris Agreements. That might be a little bit for the in crowd. This idea that there was a full agreement on the Paris Accord is not completely true. The markets participation component, Article 6, or specifically Article 6.4, has not been agreed, and it has been difficult to get agreement on that. Now, if you think about how the previous agreements like the Kyoto Protocol panned out, all of the actual movements has come from the private sector. So by agreeing everything except for the private sector contribution in the Paris Agreement, I don't think it looks very hopeful to have any meaningful results. So from that point of view, I think the best thing you can do is push your local politicians and whoever will listen to make sure there is some agreement on that at the next climate conference.
Thank you very much. There's actually an interesting point from Daniel Van Rienen before you answer, Charles, saying, how do you look at changes like more severe storms and rainfall and climate that will affect agriculture? So the point behind that is these systemic changes are awfully hard to predict and understand, and somehow counterintuitive, it would seem. But Charles, your last word here on creating a movement.
Okay, well, I'll just end on, thank you, John, thank you. I'll end on a really positive point, which is that I think we saw a positive tipping point on the 22nd of April when Joe Biden and the US announced their commitment to cutting CO2 emissions by 50% by 2030. I think for me, the world has decided to do this, okay? The world has decided to stop global warming. And then secondly, this was followed up by the G7. So the G7 made a load of commitments, including keeping 1.5 degrees within reach. So the route forward potentially is that the G7 persuade the G20, which is their meetings in before COP26, and then the G20 persuade COP26. Okay, there may be a few outliers, but you know, in essence, if that is achieved, then we could come out of COP26 with an agreement pretty well to 1.5. And for me, what's really, really important with all of this, with all, these countries are all signing up, they're signing up to what the G7's agreed. There's the world leaders agreement pledges to nature. There's the 30 by 30 pledges. There's so many pledges here that the critical thing for us to do, and I mean, I agree about voting, Henk, but for me, we can't wait for voting. We've got to do this now, which is what can be done now is to hold to account world leaders, anyone who's signed up for these pledges. We need to hold them to account to say, look, you signed up for this. On the one hand, you've signed up for this. On the other hand, you're planning to do some terrible thing to the environment or whatever. What's going on here? Now, some of these battles are going to be lost, but over time, the volume of these is going to be won because it's just not going to be acceptable for governments to sign up to pledges and then keep saying, no, they're doing stuff that doesn't meet with the pledges. So that's it for me. And this is something we can all do. We can all write to the climate, environment, prime ministers of our countries. We can do this all across the world to say, look, what's happening about what you've signed up to, what are they committed to, and hold them to account for what they have already agreed to do.
Thank you. And so thank you, Henk Sa, very much.
Pleasure.
Thank you, Charles Appleby, for standing in sort of pro bono and impromptu as our speaker. I really appreciate that. Apologies for Peter McManus, Professor McManus. He was taking his child to university, and we're not quite sure where he is. We hope he's okay in the UK somewhere. I'm sure he is, but something happened, so he couldn't join us, unfortunately. And thank you all for joining. We really appreciate it. This is just the beginning of a conversation from Henley Business School Africa about climate change, species retention, and maintaining a quality earth that all our children can live in. So thank you very much for joining us, and we're going to continue this, roused as we are by the good advice from Charles Appleby and Henk Sa. And thank you for all your questions. I'm sorry we didn't get to all of them. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Stay safe.
Thank you.